which heaven's joys o'erbright and sun. Heart of my heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler.
Welcome to our study of the book of Genesis. You'll remember that last time we began to look at the events that led up to the Noah and the Ark. Today, we're going to go forward from that, see this great man Noah, a man of faith, and observe the things that he did that we want to imitate in our lives, and of course, the things we want to avoid that were in the lives of those who lived around him. As we begin our study this morning, it's important to see that God has changed his thinking in regard to man. Notice verse 3 of Genesis chapter 6. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. Now some people look at that and they think, well, God's going to limit the amount of time that man's going to live to just 120 years. But look again, because the reality is that men live or are living longer than that at this point in time. It seems more likely that what God is saying is, I'm going to limit how long I'm going to put up with man. And in 120 years, if nothing's changed, then I am going to wipe out the world, and we'll see how in just a few moments. Man had come to reach a point to where he no longer deserved to live because of the wickedness in which he was involved. Now, he could have changed, and had he have changed, then God likewise would have changed his mind. But not so, for man does not change, and therefore God must carry through on this promise that he has made. It also should be noted that there were giants at that point in time. Some people want to attribute these to that union that we talked about last time between the sons of God and the daughters of men. However, the word for giants, Nephilim, appears in a number of places in Scripture. You may remember, for instance, that when the spies went into the land of Canaan, that they came back and reported that there were giants there, sons of Anak, who were giants. They said, we feel like grasshoppers in their eyes. So the idea that there are giants around is not significant in relation to what we've already talked about. It's just something that is observed and something that is true. It might also be said in certain senses that there are giants in our era as well. You know, someone like Shaquille O'Neal is monstrous, you know, compared to most of us. And yet, we are not surprised by him. We don't attribute his birth to the union of something other than a man and a woman. And so the same is true here in the book of Genesis. Well, God saw the wickedness around him. And it's amazing when you think about it. If you recall, back in Genesis chapter 1, every time God got through with a day, he would observe what had been created, and he would say, it is good, or he would observe that it was good. But now we find God for the first time saying that something is bad. Look on again, beginning in verse 5 of Genesis chapter 6. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What a contrast. When God made things in the creation, God made them good. In fact, when he finished the creation, including man and woman, in Genesis chapter 1 at the very end, it says that he observed and it was very good. But here, for the first time, he sees this evil, and in fact, he says, man is only thinking about evil continually. That's obviously a generic statement. It does not apply to Noah, but it applies to everybody else on the face of the earth. And it is a sad commentary on the changes that have taken place. So God is going to destroy the earth. And in fact, verse 6 of Genesis 6 continues that idea. And the Lord was sorry that He had made man on the earth, and He was grieved in His heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. Man's actions have led God to change His view of what He was going to do with man. His intent likely was that man could live eternally on the earth. That was destroyed, of course, in the sin of Adam and Eve. And now He's not even able to tolerate all the wickedness that is there. And so He's preparing to destroy man because of it. It is significant to know later in this chapter, in verse 13, that God makes a further observation and has the inspired penman write it down. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. How sad that is. Filled with violence. The word is a strong word. It is the word in the original language, Hamas. And it describes literally cold-blooded and unscrupulous infringement of the personal rights of others, motivated by greed and hate, and often making use of physical violence and brutality. Now, that was quoted in Michael Whitworth's book, The Epic of God, on this book of Genesis. So man has changed a great deal from being very good and all things around him very good at the end of creation to now being filled with violence. But thankfully, there was a good man on the face of the earth. That man, Noah. And listen to the observation about him in verse 8 of Genesis chapter 6. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Noah was a man worthy of God's grace. He lived more like God would want him to. This is not to say he never made a mistake. In fact, later we will observe that he did make mistakes. But what it does say is that basically here was a man who strove to do what God wanted him to do. And that striving led God to give him grace. He got more than he deserved, just like all of us do. But still, he was blessed by God. Notice verses 8 and 9, because there God describes this man Noah, particularly verse 9, as we've already seen verse 8. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just and perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God. Notice the words that are used. The word just means Noah lived in accord with God's will. And then he uses the word perfect. And unfortunately, when we think of perfection, we think only of someone that is totally sinless. That doesn't fit. Doesn't fit Noah. It wouldn't fit any of us either, for that matter. It only fit Jesus Christ when He walked on the earth. So what does the word perfect mean? Well, the word perfect here means upright, solely dedicated to God's service. In other words, he is a man who's focusing on the will of God, not always succeeding in following it, but generally that is his attitude, that is his approach to life. This is unimpeachable integrity, as it were. This is the kind of man that you would want to loan money to, because if he said, I'll pay it back, then you could be guaranteed that as long as the Lord let him live, he surely would pay it back. Noah had that kind of unimpeachable integrity. The same word, perfect, interestingly enough, is used for the animals that were to be used in sacrifice. They were to be perfect, that is, without blemish. Obviously, none of those animals were really perfect in the sense of without any, even the minutest little problem or difficulty, but instead they were without blemish, and so they were ready for the sacrifice. And then it says concerning Noah, he walked with God. He walked with God. This is not the first time that we've seen that expression. You'll remember that Enoch walked with God. And of course, because he pleased God, God took him. Here's another man who walks with God. And aren't we thankful that he existed because he did all that God commanded him, thereby walking with him, and he was the perfect man to use to deliver mankind through the flood so that on a new earth, once more, the earth could be populated, beginning at least with good people. Well, as we continue to look down through these things, we discover that God has Noah to build an ark. God gives him a warning. There's rain coming. There's a flood coming. Now, I really wonder if Noah knew anything about rain. We've seen no rain reported in the entire text. In fact, the earth was watered, as you may remember, with a mist. And so has Noah ever seen any rain? Has anybody else ever seen rain? We have no reason to believe that they have. But God says a flood is coming. When the writer of Hebrews looks at this chapter, and particularly at this man of faith, he says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, "By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear and prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became the heir of the righteousness which is by faith." Now, let's think about that a moment. Several things here. First of all, he moved with fear, being warned of things not seen as yet. I've already indicated he may never even seen rain. And certainly he'd never seen a flood that would inundate the entire earth. But beyond that, he'd not seen anything in the magnitude of what God was going to do. Then it says he condemned the world. Now, wait a minute. Does that mean that Noah shook his finger and said, "All of you are going to hell," or something like that? No, that's not the message at all. But instead, his good life showed that it was possible to basically do the will of God in your life. Let's see if we can think of an example. Have you ever been in a schoolroom thinking the teachers warned us that we're going to have a quiz today and I'm not ready? And so, you know the typical response of the students, that's to try to get the teacher wrapped up in explaining something and see if we can stretch it out so that we can wait and have the quiz another time when hopefully we'll be ready. Of course, whether that actually happens or not, we'll never know. But the teacher says, no, pull out your paper. And so all of us pull out our papers and we take that test. And sure enough, just about all of us bomb it. But somebody in there, well, someone we might call an egghead or a nerd or a bookworm, something like that, that somebody has prepared just like they should have, and they make a perfect 100, thereby breaking the curve, as we usually say it. What does that mean? Well, it means they showed it could be done, and thereby they condemn the rest of us to whatever score it was that we happened to make on that quiz. Well, in that sense, Noah condemned the world. His good life showed that it could be done, that you could live primarily in accord with the will of God. But all these around him lived only for their violent thoughts within their minds. And that's a tragedy that will result ultimately in their destruction. These other people refused to repent, even though Noah preached. He may well have preached during the entire time that the ark was being prepared. That seemingly is what Peter indicates in 2 Peter chapter 2. But they didn't repent at his preaching. And so God told Noah to build an ark. Now, you've seen those instructions just as surely as I have. God told him, for example, to make it 300 cubits by 50 cubits by 30 cubits. 300 cubits long. Well, first of all, we need to ask, what's a cubit? And that's a good question. A cubit is, after all, the length of the ruler's arm from his elbow to his longest finger. which normally is about 18 inches. That's the number that we usually give. And so if he was to make the ark 300 cubits in length, then it would actually be 450 feet. And then it was to be 50 cubits wide. Now that would be 75 feet. And the height of it was some 30 cubits or 45 feet. Now in our lifespan and in the buildings we see around us, 45 feet would easily be enough for three stories and some rather tall ceilings in each one of those stories. So this is a massive thing. In point of fact, there are some 33,750 feet per deck. For you see, God said, make three decks here, lower, middle, and third decks were to be made. The total square footage on the flooring inside that ark then would have been 101,250 square feet. A football field with end zones included is some 360 feet long. Remember, each end zone is an extra 10 yards. 360 feet long, but this thing is 90 feet beyond that, if you can imagine that. And I've got to admit, that's virtually beyond my imagination. It's a huge thing. It should also be observed that this ark that was created had no rudder and no sails. Now, what does that mean? When you think about it, it means that the ark was totally dependent upon God for its movement. God was going to direct where the ark would go. Instead of it being a ship like we know it with a huge keel on it, likely this is more like a barge, just a giant box, if you would. And God had him to pitch it within and without with pitch. That would be something like tar, I guess, that would fill up all the cracks between the boards, both inside and outside. He was to do that. It would then be waterproof. It was to have one door, and God talks about a window that is finished one cubit from above. It appears that that window may have gone all the way around the ark. I can't prove that, but that's just what it sounds like, and it would have needed that so that all of the heat, you know, produced by all those bodies, the animals and the men who lived in that ark, would be able to be, if you would, exhausted from the ark. So God has given his directions. He's given his directions to this man, Noah, who by the time the ark is finished is some 600 years old. Turn over to chapter 7. Chapter 7, verse 11, where it says, "So Noah with his sons, his wife and his sons' wives went into the ark because of the waters of the flood." Now the previous verses, particularly verse 6, had let us know that Noah was 600 years old when the waters of the flood were on the earth. So here's a 600-year-old man entering in with his family into the ark. As the story goes on, you notice that God shut him in. God shut the door. Now, in shutting the door, he's putting, as it were, a final stamp. A stamp on Noah as a man who lived in accord with his will. In fact, the end of chapter 6, verse 22 says, "Thus did Noah according to all that God commanded him. So did he." And we'll see that again as we go along. He's a man that kept the will of God. God stamped his approval on him when he closed up this waterproof vessel and shut he and his wife and his sons and their wives inside with all of the animals. But he also, as it were, stamped his note of disapproval on everybody else. As the waters of the flood would rise, those people who had scoffed and mocked at the preaching of Noah would now realize that Noah had truly represented God and the reality of the situation, and they might well bang to get in, but it would be too late for them. Too late because they did not heed the words of this good preacher, Noah. In verses 17 and 18, and again several other times in this text, Genesis chapter 7, we find that the flood was on the earth for 40 days. The waters increased and lifted up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters prevailed and greatly increased on the earth, and the ark moved about on the face or the surface of the waters. In the very next verse, verse 19, it says, the waters prevailed exceedingly on the earth. In verse 20, it says, the waters prevailed 15 cubits upward. The mountains were covered. This word prevailed is an interesting word. It's actually a military term, a term that describes an army that defeats another army. We have it used, for example, in Exodus chapter 17, verse 11. When you remember that the children of Israel confronted their enemy, and you may recall that as long as Moses kept his hands raised up in the air, they were winning. And whenever he would lower his hands because they were tired, they were losing. And so they had Moses to sit on a rock. And on one side was Hur, and on the other side was Aaron. And they held his arms up until the children of Israel prevailed in that battle and ultimately won the victory. That same term, prevailed, is used again in 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 23, at another instance of victory. And then a third time, the word is used in Lamentations chapter 1, verse 16, where you will remember the children of Israel were leaving their beautiful land, being carried into Babylonian captivity, and they described in their mournful song how that the enemy had prevailed over them. So now the water is on the earth, and it's on the earth to 15 cubits above the tops of the mountains. What a powerful, powerful force that must have been. And what changes it must have wrought on the face of the earth. If only we could know about all of those. Maybe we've seen a few signs of them. When you find, for example, a sea fossil, a shell, as it were, fossilized on the top of a mountain, maybe that's the reason. I don't know. We'll have to ask God when we get to heaven. In chapter 8, verse 2, we learn the fountains of the deep and the windows of heaven were also stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained. Earlier, God had opened up the windows of heaven. He had opened up the fountains of the deep, and He had caused the water to rise. Now He stops that, and the wind begins to blow, and it begins to, as it were, dry the earth, cause the water to evaporate so that man once more will be able to walk upon it. There's several notes that we could make. For example, in chapter 8, verse 4, we find the ark rested in the seventh month, the 17th day of the month, on the mountains of Ararat. So at last it's come to a halt on the top of that mountain. On in verse 5, it says, and the waters decreased continually until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains were seen. Well, of course, you wouldn't have to see the top of Ararat for a 45-foot tall ship to be lodged on its top or somewhere high up on it. And so now at last we see the tops of the mountains. In verse 6, we find, so it came to pass at the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made. What's his purpose? Well, he sends out a raven. The only thing is, when you send the raven out, the raven just keeps flying. He never comes back. And so he can't be used by Noah as a telltale sign of what's going on in the earth. So he also released a dove, and the dove came back, having found nowhere to rest her little feet. But then he will release her again. Verse 10, 7 days later, we'll note, and waited yet another 7 days, and again he sent the dove out from the ark. Then the dove came to him in the evening, and behold, a freshly plucked olive leaf was in her mouth. And Noah knew that the waters had receded from the earth. So now the water is drying up, and Noah knows about it. What is his response to that? Well, notice. So he waited yet another 7 days and sent out the dove, which did not return again to him anymore. And it came to pass in the 601st year, in the first month and the first day of the month, that the waters were dried up from the earth, and Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked, and indeed the surface of the ground was dry. Well, they've come to a rest. The earth is dried off. Noah has now ripped the roof off of the ark, and they can see once more the bright sunlight of day. And you have to know there was rejoicing, certainly among the men there, and you almost have to wonder if the animals didn't feel relief because at long last the sun was once more visible. As we continue, it says, in the second month, on the 27th day of the month, the earth was dried. Then God spoke to Noah, saying, go out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons' wives with you. So here it is, 1 year and 10 days later from the time when God placed Noah in the ark, sealed up the door. Now at last they are being bidden to come out of the ark and walk on the earth. This is a beautiful story. A story of God's deliverance, of a man who did according to all that God commanded him. It delivers to us a message, a powerful message, reminding us that we too need to do all that God commands us so that He will likewise save us. Not by means of an ark, no. Because this time, the next time that He destroys the world, it'll not be by water, but instead by fire. We'll talk more about these things in our next study.
May I reach heaven's joys, O bright and sun.